Good evening. Welcome to Dead Air Live. My name's Mimi Graney, and tonight we're going to be talking about the new exhibit that's showing at the Somerville Theater, at Somerville Museum, called The Lost Theaters of Somerville. And the guests tonight are David Guss, who's the curator, and Michael O'Connell, who's the director of exhibitions at the museum. So thank you both for coming here.
Well, thanks for having us. It's very exciting.
So what is The Lost Theaters of Somerville exhibit?
Well, it's a variety of things, but it's basically a history of Somerville's 14 movie theaters, looking at it from the very beginning of exhibition in Somerville in 1904 up to the present time. But it combines different aspects of this, so it's not just an archival memorabilia show, but it has many different aspects, such as the oral history aspect, which we've been doing for several years, commissioning of photographers to shoot these sites as they are today, and a number of different artifacts beyond just photographs that we've included in the show, as well as a series of lectures and talks in the museum.
And Michael, David brought you all these artifacts. What are some of the things that are in the show?
David found, I think initially, a group of photographs of the some of the movie theaters. There were 14 different movie theaters in Somerville throughout the 20th century. But then he continued to research the theaters. So not only do we have the photographs that show the marquee of the movie theaters and the interior of a lot of the movie theaters while they were in use, showing motion pictures, but we also have artifacts from the interior of some of the theaters. We have a column from the Broadway Theater. We have a wall sconce from the Broadway Theater, and David also found a chandelier from what was once the Ball Square Theater. Most of these theaters are not in operation any longer, and so these are things that he had to research and he found and brought to the museum, and they're included in the exhibit.
Stained glass window.
And the stained glass window from one of the nicest ones, the stained glass window from the Cross Street Church.
So how did you come across all this?
Well, it began with this totally serendipitous find. I was at a paper show a couple of years ago in Boxburg.
What's a paper show?
A paper show is also known as an ephemera show. These are shows you might have 60 to 80 dealers. There are three large ones in the Boston area per year. And they sell everything from postcards to Abraham Lincoln autographs. So there's absolutely any piece of ephemera that was on paper you can find at one of these shows. And often you find a fairly eccentric group of collectors. I like looking for still photographs, and I found this dealer who had a group of salesman photographs of Somerville theaters. Now, this salesman actually had photographed local neighborhood theaters all over eastern Massachusetts and Rhode Island. They were really unusual because people took pictures of the large picture palaces. They might have the Opera House downtown or the Majestic, things like that, but not local neighborhood theaters, as they were called, NABEs. Those were like corner grocery stores. And I was intrigued by these photographs, and I bought initially one, which was the Broadway. Went down to the Broadway Theater, which is across from Vinnie's, which is still there in East Somerville. And I could see that it was the same building, although it was transformed. And I started to talk to people in that area next door and whatnot, and they started to tell me some really wonderful stories. And from that emerged the idea of doing something larger. And I went back to the paper show 6 months later when they had it again. And I found all the pictures of Somerville theaters I could, and then I started to research them and go to these different sites. And I had no idea, for example, the Ball Square Theater. Well, very often since I teach at Tufts, I have breakfast right across the street at Kelly's Diner. And I had no idea that there was a movie theater that had existed across the street. And then I got this photograph, and I happened to walk across the street and go into Cambridge Lock, which is more or less where I thought it might have been. And I went in and I asked Nick Rosselli, the owner, do you know where the Ball Square Theater was? And he said, you're standing right in the lobby. So all that sort of was the kernel, the seed that began this project.
So this totally fit up the Somerville Museum's alley for an exhibit. What's the Somerville Museum, what type of exhibits do they normally have?
Well, there has been a series of exhibits, and the idea that David Guss brought to the museum is one in the series. We've done a series of exhibits that involve a guest curator or oftentimes a guest scholar, somebody who has been doing research on usually some aspect of local Somerville history. And the exhibit that develops at the museum typically is starting with the research and the information that that person brings to the museum, but then turning that into a visual statement, turning that into an exhibition, in other words, that can be shared with a larger public who come to the museum and see this visual material. In the case of David's exhibit, the exhibition is laid out so that as you walk through the galleries of the museum, there are a series of narratives that are presented to you, and each one of the movie theaters is presented as almost a short story or a short narrative. Then you move from that, the area that would be concerned with that movie theater, you move to another theater, so that you're essentially walking through a series of stories, small stories about each about a different movie theater.
Well, and I know part of the idea was to make it as interactive as possible along the way. Sort of give us an idea as we're walking through the exhibit. What are some of the things that would be fun to see rather than just seeing stuff?
No, well, it's exactly what Michael says. I mean, I'm interested in narrative, and it was the stories about these theaters that really sort of impelled me to do this. And certainly, you know, from the very beginning, Pearson's Perfect Pictures tells a great story. Each one of these theaters has its own narrative. And what we did as part of this project, because it's not just the exhibition, is do a life history of each of the theaters. And as part of that life history, there was a story around the theater, around the characters who owned it. In the case of Pearson, for example, what you're asking about is he was the person who first brought movies to Somerville in 1904. That's very, very early, because the first projected movie was The Kiss in New York City. It was Vitascope. It was Edison, when he projected a movie, it was 1896 in New York City. So 8 years later, you had movies in Somerville, and that's very, very early. And it was a man named Arthur G. Pearson who had a candy store and sold ice cream in the old Oddfellows Hall. And that was precisely the type of transformation of 19th century to 20th century public culture, popular culture. Men's only social clubs all of a sudden were turned into movie theaters where men, women, and children all went. And that was very, very common. You sort of see all of this in microcosm here. And I wanted to find out as much as I could about this fellow who actually became an alderman and was a very respectable gentleman in Somerville, as a lot of the movie owners and operators were. And I found out that his daughter had been a very well-known painter, Margaret Pearson. She was famous not only as an early 20th century woman painter, but she had polio, and she had really transcended these great handicaps that she had. And I saw a Xerox of a painting, a portrait that she had done of her father that she had done in 1928. And that became a long search for this painting. And finally, after 2 years, the Rockport Art Association called me and said, "We found the painting. It's in our basement. It is not on a stretcher. It was folded up. It's been probably folded up for over 50 years. And we're going to donate it to the Somerville Museum," which is really incredible, with one proviso, which is that you restore it. You cannot show it unless you restore it.
Because it'll make us look bad.
Right. And it had a crack down the middle. And so Jim Wright, who lives on Vinyl Street and is a restorer at the MFA, volunteered to do that, and he actually contributed that work to us, which was an incredible contribution, and that's in the show. That's just one of many narratives, but I think that tells something about the nature of the Somerville Museum, which is quite extraordinary, that it's really a place where volunteers contribute amazing amounts of energy and time and work, and that's quite unusual, because the Somerville Museum, it's a volunteer-run organization. It is subscription-driven, membership-driven. It has no endowment, no paid staff, and yet they're able to put on these really remarkable shows. And everybody who goes to the Somerville Museum has that same sensation. Wow, what a wonderful building. And they always ask, what was this building? And it was built as a museum in 1925, which, you know, people are always believe, oh, must have been something else.
Well, people always ask, Somerville has a museum? And where is it? Yeah, well, tell us a little bit about the museum, the background of it.
Geez. Well, the museum underwent a renovation in the during the 1980s. As David mentioned, it was originally built during the 1920s. And during the early 1980s, a group of Somerville residents got together and decided that it was maybe time to revamp and revitalize, and they did some fundraising, renovated the museum, and the museum reopened in the late 1980s with, we weren't really sure, I think, at that time, what kind of programming we were going to have and what was going to happen, but what has developed is this program that I was describing before and that David's show was a part of. We've had a series of guest curators and guest scholars who have come in. The shows typically center around Somerville because it is the Somerville Museum, but we've also added a really important element that hasn't been mentioned so far in the discussion that we're having tonight, and that is we've also tried to bring in the contemporary artists of Somerville. As everybody knows, Somerville has a really large and thriving, vital contemporary arts community of local contemporary artists. And the way that we have gotten that group involved is to, with the variety of exhibits, including this one, including the Lost Theaters of Somerville, is to, we've gathered a group of artists as we're going in, planning the exhibit, and going into the planning for the exhibit, and presented the information to them, this information about Somerville history, in this case, the stories of the movie theaters that David had collected, and the photographs that David had collected, and the other objects that he had collected. We presented this information to a group of photographers, in this case, who are all from the greater Boston area, many of whom are actually from the Somerville community. And then we asked them to go back to the sites where the movie theaters were, to go to the place as it is today, and to do a photo essay, or to put together sort of a memoir of that site that then would be shown at the museum at the same time that we showed the documentary archival photographs and the other materials that David had collected. So that's part of the show also, and it's a really important part. I think that not only are they great photographs, and we could have done a show easily, a show could be made just of these contemporary photographs, and that would be a viable show. But I think what's really interesting about having them in the Lost Theaters exhibit, as you'll see it in the museum, is that you're able to compare the photographs that were taken in the 1930s and 1940s with the photographs of the site as it is today, which in many cases is very different. So I think it's very interesting for people to see what has become of the movie theaters that David has told the story about.
Well, and the exhibit also includes oral histories with people who live in Somerville telling their stories. So we're actually going to show a little bit of that oral history and come back and talk some more about the exhibit.
Thorough enjoyment. We just love it. If you shot a gun off in the back of us, we wouldn't know it because we were so wrapped up with the movie. So, hey, that's it. And your friend was not your friend after that because you left him and he left you. And they enjoyed the movie by themselves because everybody puts themselves in their position of being part of the movie.
Movies offered a sense of escape from the everyday drudgeries of life. Through the movie-going experience, the audience was drawn into the silver screen where comedies, love stories, and action adventures were played out. But movies offered more than entertainment. They became a bridge between the traditional values of the 19th century and the modern era of the 20th century. Individual immigrant communities of Irish, Italian, and Portuguese melded into one group as they sat together and shared a common experience. They entered a physical space where normal social boundaries were blurred and prone to change. Unlike the racier Nickelodeons, movie theaters created a safe and reputable environment for women, immigrants, and children to assemble and share a new form of entertainment. During the early 1900s, Union Square was a thriving transportation hub for the eastern portion of the city. The neighborhoods that surrounded it, like Brick Bottom, Winter Hill, and Prospect Hill, used this square for their everyday shopping needs. Its central location made it a good place for other public buildings such as the post office, a firehouse, and a police office. Local impresarios such as the Cohen brothers wanted to take advantage of Union Square's central location and began the construction of one of the first theaters in Union Square. The theater, known as the Warren Street Olympia, opened in 1914 with J. Frank Mixer as the manager. Early on, it played vaudeville shows, yet it would show an occasional movie clip to its eager audience.
But they did have vaudeville acts, mm-hmm. And it cost you a pretty good penny then, about 10 cents. But I remember one theater, not this one, but one of the theaters had Singing in the Rain. Oh. I mean, that's way back in, what's his name, Al Jolson time, uh-huh. You know? Uh-huh. And I remember sitting right up front. I was flabbergasted to see these people dancing on the stage. And that's what was there before the movies. Mm-hmm. So it was all vaudeville.
In 1917, its management changed and the theater was converted into a dance hall.
But they used it for the marathon dances. They would be falling over each other and sleeping. Oh, yeah. Take over hours.
The Olympia fared well in the bustling Union Square and encouraged entrepreneurs to build a larger theater in the vicinity. In 1925, a new theater with 1,000 seats opened up in Union Square. It was built by Collegian and managed by Jack Magan. Its name was the Strand. It was built across from the firehouse at 3 Union Square and catered to a diverse neighborhood with its broad range of immigrants from Italy, Ireland, Portugal, and Greece. These groups freely intermingled with each other, but the movies were the one thing that brought them all together.
We would start off, Mom, can we go to this? Go to the movies. I don't have it. Your father didn't give me any money this week or something like that. So it was funny how you'd be persistent. You'd keep right in there all the time. Any opportunity that you had to tell them. Because that was the only real time you could have some real recreation. You can go and see a movie.
It was a thing we were going to do. We're going to go and relax and be with each other and watch the movie and you know, and the camaraderie, I guess, just be there. And probably just put everything else out of our minds that we had on our mind. See another adventure or another lifestyle, whatever it be. That's probably about most significantly why I guess we went. And it was a thing to do, too. You know.
But the theater made us stay in the community, and we went to those particular theaters. Mm-hmm. Now, we never went too far out of our particular area. So they did haul us into that community. And they were very important. That was one of our few outlets outside of playing all the kind of games that we played.
The proximity of the theaters to certain neighborhoods determined what type of people went to them.
Brick Bottom was truly a mixture of Italians, Irish, Greek, Portuguese, and...
For people living in Brick Bottom, the two theaters that were closest to them were the Strand and the Orpheum. Each one had its own characteristics.
You know, I seem to recall the Strand a lot for the better movies. The Piece Off was more like cowboys and Indians, and, you know, that was... And we loved them, too.
The Strand was a much more adult-like place.
Well, when you went to the Strand, they were a little like love stories, musicals, you know, a little bit upper scale.
The Orpheum, on the other hand, catered to a much younger and adventuresome type of crowd.
The absolute wild thing. The Orpheum was the epitome of, you know, taking over, you know, having a great time in the show.
Hi, we're talking tonight about the Lost Theatres of Somerville, an exhibit that's currently on display at the Somerville Museum. And you were just watching a clip by a video made by Stefan Luklak, who oversaw the media in the exhibit.
I did. It was a really wonderful experience.
Yeah. So what was that video all about?
Well, whole video started with a class that David was putting together over at Tufts University. And the idea was to kind of go out and do the oral histories. My interest was a little bit more towards media as well, and I thought, hey, wouldn't it be interesting to be able to, you know, do a video of the oral histories at the same time, and as part of the final project, put together a documentary of it. So, you know, went out, did the oral histories, brought along camera and everything, and put together a documentary of it.
That's right. You're a professor at Tufts, so you gathered in the resources of your students and...
I have to confess, you made me laugh by calling Luklak.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Lukash.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. I just had to explain why I've gotten so giddy. yes, I'm a professor at Tufts, and I incorporated this whole project into a course that I was teaching, and that course also worked with people from Somerville High School, which was very exciting. So the project itself and the exhibition is really about the centrality of all these theaters and cultural institutions to community and neighborhood. So the whole project tried to rebuild or create a sense of community at the same time, and all the cultural institutions of the city participated. So by the end of the project, the high school, Tufts, the museum, of course, which is fundamental to this, the library, City Hall, I'm actually on the Preservation Commission, I'm a commissioner, was participating, and the Somerville Theater became an important supporter. Even Mass Envelope, one of the largest companies, became one of our supporters as well. So it was an incredible cooperative effort. But I taught a course, and it was called Theaters of Community and the Social Production of Space.
And it's very serious.
So,
for
well,
a very fun exhibit.
And well, it's actually the course is going to continue and look at other things afterwards in terms of thinking about these questions, and is going to go on and actually look at colleges and particularly the architectural space of universities in the Boston area. But that's a future project. But in any case, the course, one of the things that we were doing was to do these oral histories. And the first semester, which was last spring that we did it, the students went out and they did over 65 oral histories, most of them transcribed from a database that we created of over 95 people who were willing to participate. It was quite remarkable. And each person decided on a final project they wanted to do. And three of those projects were actually in the exhibit. They're really interesting. And Stefan's was by far the most ambitious, which was creating the film based on his oral histories.
And this was the first video you ever made?
First, definitely. First time I went out, you know, on the field, interviewing people, and kind of jumped right into it.
Yeah.
Learn as you go.
Start.
Yeah, definitely very ambitious. You know, I remember sending a schedule down to David and saying, you know, on this date I'll do this, this, and this. And he said, good luck, Stefan. You know, it happened. It happened. You know, just kind of ran right through it.
Huh. So who were some of the people that you interviewed? Can you kind of give us the background?
Yeah, definitely. I know that one of the people that was on the video was Fred Lund, who is the city cartographer. Fortunately, one of David's assistants, TA, Kathy Stanton, and David as well, got in contact with a lot of the people and set up the initial, you know, these are the people that you should go to talk about a particular theater. And Fred was one of them. You know, wonderful guy, sat down in his office and, you know, he pulls out all his maps and says, you know, this theater was here, and kind of gave me a list. And you know, from there you go on trying to learn more about how the theaters affected his life, how he, you know, how he snuck into them with his friends, how he met a significant other there, and all the stories related to it.
Oh, you make that sound so proper, a significant other there.
I guess a lot of times I'm going off with what they said, and, you know, I think especially Marty Avedisian talked about, you know, that was the place where couples met and things like that, and he always referred to significant other.
Well, these are really wonderful people that mm-hmm. Stefan worked with, and that all the students had the opportunity to do ethnographies with these people and to experience what it means to do oral histories, which is such an incredibly moving interchange when people start to tell you these personal stories about their childhood and past. And it's a real gift, and a lot of the students really felt that, and I think they were sort of bitten with that bug, which I've had all my life because I became an anthropologist mm-hmm. based on that experience. But they really are incredible people, mm-hmm. and such as Fred Lund, who's I think going to be recognized for his contributions to the city perhaps in next week at Patriots Day, I'm not sure, but he has consistently been involved in the flag raising and Patriots Day events, and he's been the city cartographer for many, many years, and he immediately contributed maps that all my students used, where he actually put all the different theaters on the maps, which was very important because tough students couldn't even find the library. I mean, they had never been beyond Davis Square, basically. So that was quite an adventure for most of the students, which was part of the power of this course, to see what was actually out there in the community.
Yeah. So as a tough student, how do you see Somerville differently after doing this project?
I think definitely looking back, it's broadened my horizon as far as Somerville. I think too many times in college, you've got your nose stuck in the books and, you know, don't really have a chance to go out and explore it. And this was kind of, you know, part of the assignment was to go out, to learn about the people, to learn about the community, to learn about the history of it. And it gave me an opportunity, one, to learn about, one, the geography of Somerville, you know, be able to get around, be able to find the library, and also find out about the community itself in Somerville. One of the groups that I became really close to lived in Brick Bottom, and learning all the history of what used to be Brick Bottom and now how the MacArthur Highway has torn down significant portions of it, and just a lot of the history related to it.
Mm. Yeah, and how do you relate to Somerville differently after doing this exhibit?
Well, that's a good question. I grew up in the New York area. I lived in California for about 20 years, which is where I went to school. And I think that I was looking for a project like this in a certain way that really connected me to the community. I have a lifelong interest, not only in historic preservation. I've been on historic preservation commissions and a preservation activist in different places for many years, but having this project really made me feel much more rooted in Somerville, which is an adopted hometown for me now. And not only the countless people that I met during this project, but a real feeling for the landscape. And that was really, that was quite moving. And that was a wonderful experience for me. So, and after this project, you know, I know people in every part of the community because I went to all the various places where the theaters were, and I had to deal with a lot of the businessmen as well, and not only in raising money, but in terms of borrowing artifacts and borrowing photographs. So it really rooted me in the city very, very much. It's a fascinating and unique city.
Yeah. What's your favorite piece in the show?
my favorite piece in the show. There
and you can't say Stephens.
Well, there are different pieces, but there's a one Teal Square poster which I really have always loved. It's probably from about 1927. It's just when sound movies are coming in. And it's an oversized poster. It's probably about 11 by 17. And in the middle of it is a strong man who's on the top of the Teal Square Theater. And he's got a board with, he's sitting down, and he's called the strongest boy in the world. And there's two women on each side seesawing. And then on the bottom of it, and you're going to see the strongest boy in the world do his act. And on the bottom of it is this remarkable ad for The Heart of a Somerville Girl. And the ad for The Heart of a Somerville Girl is an ad for a movie that's being made on stage at the Somerville Theater. Maybe this Teal Square too, where this is the ad is for. But people from the audience are coming up and participating in this movie that's being made, and then it's announced that at the end of the week, the movie's going to be shown at all the movie theaters. And this is a classic home movie, or what's called town movie. You might think of it as a home movie, but these were called town movies, one-of-a-kind movies where people from the community actually got to be in movies. And part of this, of course, in early movie going, people were as fascinated by the technology as they were by the contents of the movie itself. And you really see that in that. And The Heart of a Somerville Girl has never been found. Probably there was only one print, and it might never be found, although there's an archive of town movies that exists at Northeast Historic Film. But this whole poster and the amount of activity that's on it has always intrigued me. It might be one of my favorite pieces. And subsequently, I found another series of posters and ads which talked about another home movie that was made in 1917 during Patriots Day and a flag-waving ceremony in Union Square right outside here. And they described making a town movie with Mayor Zebediah Cliff, who was actually in the movie. And that movie seemed to have been a narrative which was constructed around that event. And that movie was also shown in all the theaters in Somerville. Mm. It is so intriguing to think about finding one of these movies, if they actually exist.
Well, I love that the exhibit includes a whole series of lectures and different events to sort of tell people the behind the scenes, sort of tell the stories behind the artifacts. What are some of the lectures you've had so far, and what's planned?
Well, the first one we had Catherine Fuller, who's a professor at Virginia Commonwealth University, who's a wonderful speaker, and she is the world's expert on Dish Night. And she's really, she's a historian of the movie-going experience, the author of a book called Talking at the Picture Show. And she gave a great talk about Dish Night. And for people who aren't aware of it, there were a lot of promotions at all of these theaters. And the central part of the exhibition really talks about the movie-going experience, which was common to movie theaters everywhere in the United States during this period. So we actually have a lot of dishes that were given away at these different theaters that are in the show. Mm-hmm. And she talked about that commercial aspect of the giveaway culture. And she talked about Bank Night, which was a very important thing that also happened in Somerville. That was a very well-attended event. And then this past week, Garen Daly, who was the former manager of the Somerville Theater, as well as the Dedham Community and the Orson Welles and also Coolidge Corner, one of the great independent theater people in this area. He spoke along with Don King, who's a theater owner who used to work with E.M. Lowe and was, as he said, the head usher when there were two head ushers in 1938 and 39 at the Orpheum before World War II. And then he went off and moved to Washington where he owned theaters. And he's just written a book about Boston theaters, the history of Boston theaters. And he was also up here testifying at the public hearing over whether to turn the Gaiety Theater on Washington Street into a historic landmark or to demolish it, which is being proposed by the BRA, which is an important issue on the table right now. So those two people spoke, and that was also standing room only, a wonderful event, very, very exciting. And we're going to, I'm going to actually give a curator's tour next Thursday.
That's
but
Thursday, April 17th.
April 24th.
Oh, April 24th.
So a week from this Thursday, April 24th. And we're planning a series of events that are very exciting for the fall.
Okay, good. Well, we actually have a video of one of the events, the opening, that was a couple weeks ago, and that'll give you sort of a sense of what it looked like inside the exhibit.
A-I-D-A, but it's pronounced Ada Denning, D-E-N-N-I-N-G.
And what, can you tell me some of the stories of the movie theaters that you remember?
Well, I remember going to the Central Theater, and they used to give away the china, you know, and the movie changed. My sister collected the china, the flatware, from the Central Theater, and I saw the popcorn at the Capitol Theater when I was much younger.
Now, how old were you when you started working at the theater?
Dear Lord, in about 1940, I think it was.
Do you remember how much you made per week?
25 cents an hour. Big money. I think I made $1.50 for the afternoon.
Wow.
So, big change today. What did they get for a bag of popcorn today? At least $2. So that, I go way back.
And I heard you also took part in one of the dance marathons that was held?
I didn't take part. I watched it. Mm-hmm. I used to work for Gorns. Gorns was the retail store at Union Square. They had the dance marathon in back of Gorns where they danced as long as they could stand until they dropped. So we used to watch, you know, go in there and watch them. And it was so interesting. Some of them really stood up very long, you know.
How long is very long?
More than 2 days. Without stopping, no rest period. So, I don't really remember, you know, the records now, but I remember that very well. And that lasted quite a while. So, I think that was the Strand Theater in back of Florence. And
now, what neighborhood did you live in?
That was the Union Square neighborhood, and I lived in the Union Square neighborhood at that time on Stone Avenue. Mm-hmm. But I've also lived St. Catherine's Parish, and now I live in the, well, I'm still in St. Catherine's Parish, but I'm near the high school now. So I moved around, but in Somerville. So I married in Somerville.
Now, movies, which movie theater did you go to?
Oh, to all of them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which one was your favorite?
The Central, because it was the handiest. You know, I used to live on Stony Avenue, and then when I lived on Belmont Street, it was just a short walk, really, from there. You know, so.
Did any big life moments, like was your first kiss happening in a movie theater?
My first date.
Yeah?
My first date, my only date, you might say, from the time I was 16, because I married the man.
Stephanie Clavins.
And what's your connection with the show?
I'm one of the photographers, and we're standing in front of my work right now. I photographed the Somerville Theater and also what is left of the Broadway Theater.
And what were your impressions of the two theaters?
They're very different. I love the Somerville because it's the last remaining movie palace of the 14 that were originally here, and it was so bittersweet to really go visit the Broadway because because there's still some of the architectural details remaining, but so much is gone. The seats have been ripped out. It was used as a carpet warehouse for a while, so it was great to have a chance to get in and shoot it, but sad to see how little remains.
Shooting each of the theaters in the Somerville, you probably got to see some of the behind-the-scenes parts of the theater, or no?
A little bit. Went backstage, had free run of the place. I was able to stand in the side boxes and do some of the shooting from that perspective, which made for some nice shots. That's how I actually took this picture right here. They were very accommodating. The manager was totally into the project.
Now, did you do special lighting to get some of these great effects, or is that the lighting already in the theater?
Well, I usually shoot with existing lighting. I shoot long exposure, but in this particular picture here, I tried something different, and I actually photographed that by the light of the movie being projected on the screen. So these are people you can see a little bit watching the movie, and that took an hour exposure to get that picture.
Wow.
So, and it kind of gave a nice light effect, as you can see. It has a good mood to it.
It's amazing. Some of those people aren't moving at all.
It must have been a good movie.
Yeah. And what's your overall impression of the exhibit as a whole?
Oh, I think it's a great show. I'm really glad I was able to be involved. I've been photographing theaters for a long time. It's a personal project of mine, which is, I think, how I got involved. Someone knew about my work and mentioned my work to David Guss. And it's a subject that's so dear to my heart that I'm really excited I had a chance to be included in the project.
What is it that attracts you to theaters?
I just think it's an important part of American social history. It's an important part of architecture and design. They were so fanciful. They were done in so many different themes, and they're really disappearing, like so much 20th century American, the American built environment of the 20th century is just going on. So I really try to preserve what's left through my photography.
So tell me a little something about your look tonight.
I've got this great hat. Came from a flea market in Los Angeles, Carmen Miranda, and I figured if I couldn't wear this hat to this show, where could I wear it?
So that's great. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Mimi.
Yeah, it's Nancy Kalajian.
And what's your memory of the Somerville Theater?
Well, we used to go up the, when you face the theater, there would be a door to the left, and we would go up that door upstairs to Helen Nichols School of Dance. And probably for at least, 25 years, if not more, she taught dancing lessons, tap and ballet and vaudeville style. She was very dynamic.
And what years were those?
God, it was probably in the 50s that we took our lessons, and I took my tap lesson. So as we would wait, because Helen was quite busy, and my sister and I took lessons, and my sister also took some, I took group classes, my sister took solo classes as well, but I would sometimes have to wait while my sister was inside until the group class began. And sometimes the projectionist would go in and out of the doorway, and it was very loud waiting out there. I didn't know what the movie was, but I was wishing I could see it, because, you know, he was, as we would wait for Helen to open our door, the projection room was to the left, and it was quite loud. So for many years, you know, she did really the style of dance, vaudeville kinds of things, and she was very dynamic, and she was really one of the most popular dance instructors in Somerville for probably children growing up, probably between 40s and early 70s, I'd say.
How do you feel about its life now?
Well, now it's nice, because I'm glad that they've stripped off a lot of the additions that were made, and now you can see some of the natural decorations. And I think it's good. It's a multi-use theater, which is great, because there's movies and there's musical acts and other venues. So I think it's wonderful in how it's adapted to the times, and I'm glad it's still there for all to enjoy and to celebrate.
Thank you very much.
Sure.
And who are you? I'm Mary Kokel, and I'm one of the photographers for the theater project.
And which theaters were you looking at?
I photographed the Lowe's Assembly Square, and also just the lobby of the Somerville Theater, and the Pete's Orpheum, which used to be the Unitarian Church many years ago.
Now, I see with Assembly Square lobby, you used a different kind of technique to capture it.
Mm-hmm. I used a panoramic photography technique, which involves taking 16 photographs in a circle, and then I have special software which stitches them together, and then I did a little retouching in Photoshop.
So it's a 360 photo of it.
Exactly. Yeah, and we have the printout here at the show. And then if you go to the website, you can also see you can see a QuickTime version of it, so people can like scroll through the movie. So it's just like a spinning space. It's kind of like you're actually in the space.
So what attracted you to this exhibit?
You mean to take the pictures? Well, it's a, you know, another Somerville project, and I always like to do, it sounded like a nice big community project, so I always like to participate in stuff like that. It was sort of like the theater version of the Garden Awards kind of thing. And David had seen my work and asked me to take pictures for him, so, and of course, I just love old movies and movie theaters. I mean, who doesn't? So it's a lot of fun.
What were some of the things that you really particularly loved about the theaters that you photographed?
Well, I thought what was interesting was you would see, like, I would get the address from David or whoever and go to the place, and it would be totally different than what it used to be. Like, for instance, the Pete's Orpheum is now like a luxury condo unit. And so it was just kind of an interesting process to see how the theater used to be there, but then just has layers and layers of new layers of what it is now. Does that make sense? So.
Thank you very much.
Sure. Is this for Scat?
Yeah.
Albiano.
And I know you are
my husband owned the Somerville, the Broadway, the Teal Square, and all kinds of theaters. I've forgotten them all. All the theaters in Broadway except the Ball Square. He didn't own that. Then they also ran the Capitol Theater, and they had the Regent in Arlington. And what else? Oh, it's just, and all of the memorabilia is for me. I saved it all. I went to my husband's office one day, and there was an old desk, and it had all this stuff in it. So I took it all out, saved it. And so when David Gus was having this thing, he came to my house, and he was astounded. And I had a lot of big posters, like Saturday Night Live and Elvis Presley, Love Me Tender. But I guess they didn't have room to put everything up, because this is really not a lot of, it's not a great big place. It's just little tiny rooms, you know, here. So what else do you want to know?
So what's your favorite piece in the show?
Oh, I do like that. I think that's beautiful. And I like the pictures of my husband with his dad and his brother. I love that. And I love the article that they wrote about all the theaters, too, over there. Beautiful. I'm going to have to come again when people aren't with me so I can just really check it out, because they want to go home pretty soon.
So what's one of your favorite stories about being in the theaters?
When I told my husband I married him because I wanted to go to free movies, and he had a 50-foot schooner. I said, I married you for the movies and the schooner.
And the popcorn.
My name is Joe Burke.
And what's your connection to the exhibit?
Well, I'm the head of the history department at Somerville High, and we recruited some students to participate in the oral interview part of the project.
And what do you teach?
I teach history, or I administer the department in history.
So what kind of things were the students involved in? How did this connect with their other studies?
Well, the students paired up with students from Tufts to interview people who worked for the theater or were patrons of the theater. And it connected to our local history section of American history.
Were they excited to participate, or did you have to rope them into it?
No, it was a great opportunity for them. And we managed to work out a schedule so that the kids could participate in this, because most of the interviews were done after school at night, and they had to attend a few classes at Tufts University as well. So it was an opportunity for them, but also meant a lot of work on their part after the normal school day.
And getting to take part in a college-level class must have been a great opportunity for them.
It was wonderful for them. And I went up with them on a few occasions, where they sat in, and they were trained in doing oral histories by Professor Gus and some of his students. And then they got to go out in the community and interview people. And it was a great experience for them.
Caitlin White, Nellie Tavares, and you're looking very dapper tonight. Why are you all dressed up?
We volunteered to be ushers at the opening of the exhibit on the museums.
And what's your connection to the project?
Well, we volunteered through Somerville High School to help with the research and going out and doing interviews and then transcribing them and things like that.
Sounds like a lot of work.
Well, it was long, but it was very interesting to learn about the roles that the theaters played in the community. So it was a learning experience as well as taking up our time.
People can remember so vividly about so long ago. I can't remember what I ate for dinner last night. And they can remember what it smelled like, what they felt like to sit in the theater and watch the movies. And that was just really amazing.
Hi, you're watching Dead Air Live, and we're talking about the Lost Theaters of Somerville exhibit that's currently on display at the Somerville Museum. And we're joined now with Mary Kokel, who's one of the contemporary photographers who took part in the show. So what were the theaters that you were looking at?
Well, I photographed the Pizza Orpheum on Cross Street and also the Somerville Theater lobby. I did a 360 panoramic inside there, kind of a special project. And also, what was the other one? I know.
You did the Lowe's Assembly Square.
Yeah, that was part of the epilogue. So I always forget about that one just because it's not a historical one, but it was one of the current theaters. So yeah, the Lowe's Assembly Square. Thanks.
But you did great photos of them. They were wonderful.
Well, and I guess all the contemporary photographs that are part of the show are really sort of an epilogue of what happened to the places now.
That's true.
What was sort of your response by seeing those spaces now?
Well, the Pizza Orpheum was very interesting because it has such a history to it. Like, at first it was the Unitarian Church, and then it became a plumbing supply store, and then now it's a luxury condo place. And I got to go inside some of the luxury condos, and they're really beautiful, overlooking the train tracks, but still very beautifully designed inside. And there are a few businesses in there as well, designers. There's a photographer in there and a few other businesses. Hmm. So it's kind of neat to see the transition of the transformation of the building over time.
Hmm. It's interesting that when Mary went in there and she told some of the people that there had been a theater there, they were totally unaware. Hmm. It's called a sanctuary. So the developer wanted to acknowledge the fact that it had been a First Universalist church, which had actually opened first in 1854, burnt down. But the building that's there now was built in 1869. Mm. But then it had this whole other history, which they were not acknowledging or mentioning in the brochures. And so people were quite surprised, and in some cases quite delighted, because they worked in video and whatnot. Isn't that case?
Yeah, actually, that's a good point. It just reminded me, the design team that's in there, they're in the semicircular part of the building where it used to be the former entrance to the movie theater. And they were kind of thrilled to find out that it was once a movie theater. And they actually have a little video installation going on, just like with a projection screen. So it was kind of interesting to be able to tell them that this was once a movie theater. So kind of the spirit of, you know, moving images is still within that little space. Hmm. So.
And we have an interesting part in the exhibition which talks about this whole process of architectural reuse, which is one of the themes throughout the show. In 1913, they converted it from a church to a movie theater, and they covered the 8 stained glasses to make the movie hall. They left them in perfect condition, and those were there for, 90 years. They were covered up. And when Rocco Antonelli, who bought this building, tore down the walls to open those windows, he found the 8 stained glass windows in absolutely immaculate condition. He put them in a garage and really didn't pay attention or do anything to them, even though he highlighted the original windows in the condominiums today.
And we asked if we could use one of them in the show. And he was very generous, and he let us use one of those. And Barbara Mangum, who is a conservator who used to work at the Isabella Gardner Museum, came over, and she cleaned it for us. And she said, it is an extraordinary stained glass. The quality of it is really remarkable and very, very high quality. And then Michael O'Connell, who did the installation, figured out a way of backlighting it, so you really see it in a very luminous way. And it makes it a very interesting sequence to look at the architectural reuse of this building over now three centuries.
Mm-hmm. So of the 14 great movie palaces and just little naves in Somerville, mm-hmm. the only one that's still alive is the Somerville Theater. Mm-hmm. What was it like doing a 360 photo in that lobby?
It was a lot of fun. I went in on a night when they were having a concert going on, so there was like a huge amount of people in the crowd just milling about in the lobby. And if the people go and see the photo, they'll notice that there's one of the guys behind the counter and a customer was willing to ham up the picture a bit for me and just give a nice big smile and as he was receiving some popcorn and stuff. And then one of the girls taking the tickets also helped pose for the picture. So it was really nice. Yeah. It was a lot of fun. It's kind of like making a little production. You know, it's like a sort of a tableau, like kind of a posed photo, but also some people are unaware that they were having their picture taken. But, you know, yeah. So I enjoyed it. And it's always fun. It's one of the things I enjoyed doing, working on a computer, stitching together the pictures with Photoshop. It's a lot of fun.
So the Lost Theatres of Somerville is going to be up for a year. Mm-hmm. So it's closing March 2004, which
That's
seems
right.
very far away, but people shouldn't wait to see the show.
That's right. Unlike what we always do with the MFA and whatnot, run down the last day, people should come. And particularly because it's a large exhibition. It's a small museum, but there is a lot of wall text. There's a lot to see. There's a lot of interactive materials, such as Stephen Lukacs' movie, as well as we have a CD which is stitched together many of the oral histories. So people will want to spend some time there, and they'll probably want to come back more than once. Yeah. And they'll also perhaps want to come to some of our events. And again, we are going to have a whole series of new events in the fall. Yeah.
So people can find out more about that by looking at the website, mm-hmm. which is www.losttheaters.org, and it's theaters, T-R-E-S. Mm-hmm. So I want to thank you both for being here tonight to talk about the show and for our other guests that were here. And thanks to the crew of Dead Air Live for helping us to tell you about the programs at the Somerville Museum.
Oh, that's great. Well, thank you very much. This has been great fun.
Yeah.
It's been wonderful.
Great.
Good show.
Okay, we'll just talk among ourselves while they roll the credits.
Okay. We shall do that.